Hello, everybody, and welcome to Factorio. In this episode, I will be talking about trains. In the version 1.13, they have been changed, which is awesome. I mean, look at this new model we have. They can even change colors, which I will cover a bit later in the episode. But I wanted to give you guys a quick start on how to get your trains up and running if you've never done it before. But I also will cover how I build my track, how I build my stations. I'll cover rail signals, chain signals, how to set up your stations, and how to get your trains going between those stations automatically so you don't have to worry about all those resources going back and forth between your base and your mines or wherever else, so you can keep on doing what you do in Factorio. So let's get started. So I am here in the desert because building train tracks actually takes quite a bit of space. I wanted to give you a comparison here between a transport belt, a car, and the train tracks themselves. So the train tracks are a 2x2 entity while the transport belt is a 1x1. So as you can see, this can grow pretty large. All right, with that out of the way, let's start building. I'll just delete all of these. To build, simply click and drag just as you would the transport belt and run, right? The other thing you can do is click on one of these arrows. For example, if I click on the left one, I can extend the track wherever I want. I can even make a turn. And if I extend it longer, there is a limit. There is a limit on how much you can extend. So you would be building by sections, but you can curve it and twirl it and however you want. Click and place the track down. If you shift and left click, then you get quite a bit of range on this. As you can see, I'm going pretty far against my screen. The only disadvantage, I would say, in this, unless you have robots, is that this is a blueprint mode. So when you place the train track down, it will be highlighted, it will be ghost track, right? The blueprint track. So you would have to actually manually build it, unless you have robots, which they will automatically build it for you. Now, the other thing you can do, well, so first of all, actually, you have to select the trail. See, I have, I don't see those arrows anymore, so you have to actually take those train tracks, and then you will see the arrow. So you click on the, shift-click the arrow. Now here are some trees. The pathfinding will automatically go through the trees without taking the trees down. If I hold shift, on the other hand, I can get a more direct route, but it will automatically mark the trees down that are in the way. So again, if you have robots, these will be automatically deleted. However, I will have to manually delete this tree if, of course, I don't have the robots, and then I will have to complete the track. So that is the track building in a nutshell. Let's place an actual train on the track. And there we go. Easy as that, we have a train. It does need some fuel, so if you click on the train, it will bring up the train dialog. We can go to the fuel tab. As you can see, there's three spots for fuel, so I have three coals. You don't have to put all of them. Now, the train can of course run by any standard fuel, either wood, coal, or solid fuel. Once you place it in, you can get in the train by pressing enter. And of course, the autosave pops up. Pressing enter. There we go. Now you can drive the train by pressing the W to go forward or S to go backward. In this case, of course, it's W is to the left and S is to the right. If I place the track sort of this way, do that. Getting close to my base here. I press W, it's just going up now. I can go up and down. Great. Easy as that. Now, let me change the color. We can go to the color. and we can actually zoom in on this preview right here with your scroll wheel if you have that mouse. Let me make it some random color here. I don't know, let's make it green or something. Yeah, green train, why not? All right, now if you have a cargo wagon, you can attach it to the train by simply having it very close to it, and it will automatically snap to the tracks, and then if you get close to the actual locomotive, it will snap to it as well, and then you can click to confirm. You can again get in the train and ride. You can also get in the cargo wagon, and you can actually still control the train from the cargo wagon. So if you have, if you're playing multiplayer game, you can drive the train or have you and have your buddy ride in the back, or the reverse. Your buddy could be driving the train and you could be riding in the back. You can also rotate the train. So here I have another locomotive and I am rotating with the R button. Now I'm going to place it the opposite way, just like that. Also, of course, it also needs fuel, but you can still drive it without that fuel. Lights turn on. But if you get into this one, nope, you, awesome, you can still drive it. So as long as you have one engine having fuel, you can drive it. But I'm gonna put fuel in this one as well. Now, I'm gonna back up here and add a train station here. Train stop. And once you select it and you get near the tracks, it will actually tell you all the possible positions for the train stop. And also, those white highlights are exactly where the cars of the train would stop. The yellow arrows are the direction the train needs to be facing in order to actually arrive at the train stop. So if I place it on the other side, on the top side, as you can see, the arrows actually reverse. So it would be, it would be needing to come from the right to actually get into the station, or in this way it would come from the left. So I'm gonna place my train station like so, because this train is facing, is coming from the left facing right, right into the station. So it's going right along those arrow lines. Now the train station has a random name once you put it down, so you can rename this stop, and we will call it right. All right, and then we can put another stop over here. Now this is not the right side, we want this side because the train is going to be coming from the bottom up. So we'll put the train stop on this side and this time, and we will rename it, say, left. I mean, it's, I guess, technically up, but whatever, it doesn't matter, you can name them whatever you want. So now we will see how to actually program the train to go between the two stations. So if I click on the locomotive, actually, you know what, before I do that, let me delete this locomotive and show you what happens without it there. So I can go into the schedule, right? And I can click the plus button to add a station. So what I'm gonna do is add the left station. And now it's asking for a wait condition. So how long should the train actually wait at the station? Usually you wanna do inventory full or inventory empty. If you have more complex things set up with circuits and whatnot, you would do item count, circuit condition, perhaps an activity. I actually never tried those, so feel free to experiment with those. But these two are pretty, or these three are pretty much the most common ones that you will use. So let's say we're keeping it simple, we're just gonna do time passed. So it's gonna wait until 30 seconds have passed and then it's gonna do something else. In this case, we don't have it for anywhere else to go, so it's just gonna stand there indefinitely. So let's actually get in the train, why not, and ride in the train as I flip the switch to the automatic. It goes to the train station and it stops at the train station. If you can see, when I hover over the train station, it shows the positions of where the train is supposed to be, and as you can see, the train fits exactly where they are. Now the train is just gonna wait there because it doesn't know where else to go. Okay, so what if we wanted the train to go back and forth between these two stations? Okay, so we will just add another one, right? Add the right station. Time passed, say 30 seconds. Well, you know what, here. You can adjust the timer here to say 15 seconds, and the left is 15 seconds as well. See what happens. Automatic. It's probably waiting right now. Oh, no path. There we go. That's what I was waiting for. No path. What do you mean no path? There is a path, right? There's a station. There's the station. Why is there no path? Well, it's because this locomotive can only go forwards in automatic mode. Yes, you can back up with it manually, but it just doesn't know how to do that apparently when it's in automatic mode. So, if you have a single track like this, you need to add another locomotive facing the other direction as we did before. Added some fuel to it. Why not? And now, let's see. Will it go? Ah, it's on manual. Let's put it on automatic again. There we go. There we go. There it is. Running to the other station. It's gonna wait 15 seconds and then go back to the top one. Now this is a very simple one track, two ways on one track sort of a deal. Now for complex routes, you may or may not want to use this. Now, I personally choose not to use a single track for all of my routes. So I'm gonna leave this train here and let's take a look at what I have set up over here. What is this complexity, right? Okay, so here I have two train tracks. I have a dedicated line for going up and a dedicated line for going down. So this line right here, no trains on this line will ever go down. They will always go up. And this line, no trains will ever go up. They will always go down. So I actually took the train from this one from the intro. So let's place it down. Just like so, get in it, place some fuel, and ride along the line. As you can see, I always go down here. Now in this roundabout, I turn around. Now you can, if you're on the roundabout like this, you can specify the direction the train will go. So for example, I want to go to the left, so I will hold down the A key while I am moving forward, pressing the W key. W key moves forward, I'm holding down A, and I will turn to the left. Wonderful. If I want to go to the right, I will press D. So W, D, and I go to the right. Simple as that. And I can navigate all of my train tracks just like that. So as you can see, I never go back on the other one. Now, to enforce that, we have, of course you can actually pick up the train and put it here just facing this way, but in automatic mode, we want to enforce that somehow, so that's what we have these rail signals for. So let's check out what they do. If you put them anywhere, same as the train stops, they will show those, you know, yellow arrows pertaining into the direction that the train should be coming from to the train signal. So if I place them on the right side, it's gonna say we're going forward, and on the left side is going backward. And actually, for some reason, I think because I have it set up already in this way, that it's actually not allowing me to place them on here. Yeah. Which is actually pretty cool. So if I place a regular track down, yeah. So a regular train track with none of these loops will allow you to place these train signals on either side. So I can place them here, going forward, and place him here to go backward. But in a setup like this, you can only place him on one side, which makes sense because that's what we want. We want the train signal, the trains to go in one directions, because we don't want any collisions. I mean, imagine a train going up and then the train going down on the same track. If you had a single track, there is a possibility of a collision. However, you can use these train signals to prevent that. Now, at the roundabouts, collisions can happen. So what I usually do is place a train signal at the end of the roundabout, of the exit, right? So at the exit, I place a train signal. And this will say, okay, well, is the way clear in front? So the way these work is, you know, the ask is the way in front clear? If so, they're green. Awesome. The way in front is clear and there's nothing there. It's green. Wonderful. So I'll put another train signal at the exit here. You can place them anywhere along these green lines. So I'll just pick a random spot. Now this one, as you can see, is blinking. The reason it's blinking is because it doesn't really know what's going on here. I don't have enough of these placed in order to actually know what's going on. Now I have these signals placed in my train station, and that's why this one is green. Now you might wanna, you'll probably end up doing something like this in the beginning. Place a regular signal there at the start. In here. So you would think, okay, well, the train is coming in from this side. It wants to go onto the roundabout, right? So it checks, okay, is there anything in front of me, right? And then it will go if it's green, and it will stop if it's red. But consider the fact if one train is stopped right over here, because we have this ending light over here, so it's past this one, it's going in and it's stopping because there's a train in the way here and this is red. So I will simulate this situation like so. I'll put a cargo wagon here, okay? Boom, see, it's red because it's sensing there's something in the way. Now this train, if it's on automatic mode, will stop. Oh, forgot to turn the right way. So let's go around the loop. So as you can see, it's green, now it's red, and when I reach, so in here, this one becomes red because there's something in here, but this one will always go past this one because it's the way it's clear to go, and it will stop here, but it's blocking now the roundabout. So if a train is coming in and it just wants to turn around, it's not going to be able to do so. And so this is where train signals come in. So instead of stopping here, right, really what we want to do is stop the train before it gets to the intersections. And chain signals help us do that. What they do, now I deleted the other one, and I'm replacing it with a chain signal here. As you can see, it's red. What it does, it's looking ahead and asking, okay, what's the next rail signal is reading? Is it red? Is it green? Okay, and I am going to mimic exactly what the other one is showing. So this way, this one looks ahead and sees that this one is red, so it's going to tell the train to stop here before getting into the roundabout, so it doesn't block it for any trains that actually want to go on it. And I'll replace the same one, or this one, because this is an entrance, I will place it with a rail signal there. Now I will do so also over here. So I'll put a chain signal at the entrance, and regular rail signal at the exit. Now, we have dedicated sections of track where trains can stop. For example, this part, as you can see, any trains coming in from the roundabout will have to stop here right now. Though ideally, we wish them to stop here. So So let me add actually chain signal here and here. So you always want to put a chain signal at the start and a regular signal at the end of at the exit of your roundabout. So let's see what we have here. We have a new color, blue. What does this mean? Well, if you're here, right, as this train can go either up here, right, where it's red, where it's blocked, or it can turn around and actually go this way where it's green. And so the blue is saying, depending on where the train actually is planned to go, it will actually stop or continue. So if it wants to go up, it will stop. But if it wants to just turn around and go back here, it's free to do so. So that's what the blue means. So this setup, while thinking about, all you have to do is really think, what is my entrance? Is what is my exit? And you're all set pretty much for rail signals. It's easy as that. It doesn't have to be super complicated. I know when I first started, I'll be putting them everywhere because I was really confused about where the train should stop, where it should go. It's really as simple as thinking about what is my entrance, what is my exit, and putting a chain signal on the entrance and a regular signal at the exit. So this way, the train will go on its merry way around the track. So now see, these are green now because all the directions are clear. So here I am in a much larger part of the train system. There's a long track, and this is to demonstrate what happens when you only have train signals that are just at the entrance and the exits of this roundabouts, right? So what if this train, for example, here ran out of fuel, and perhaps it's here, perhaps it's all the way over there down the line, and we have another train waiting on, trying to get onto this line to go forward. What would happen if you only have them at the starts and the exits is that the train will just stop here. As you can see, this is red, and it will just stop here and wait. And any trains that, for example, need to go this way will not be able to go through the roundabout and will just be stuck there. So to solve this problem, we would just need to put rail signals. What I do usually is have these poles as markers for me. These big electric poles are pretty much set at the maximum distance. They have nice lights here to light our train tracks so we can enjoy the scenery even at night as we ride through the train, right? So anyway, what we would do is place these rail signals here and here across, you know, for each side. And this, now what happens is this turned blue. Okay, well, blue means that one way is free, one way is closed. Of course, this way is closed, and you know, perhaps it doesn't need to go there, right? It wants to go here. So now I can actually go through, and where will it stop is right at this pole here. So now when it goes through, the roundabout will be clear for the next train to pass through here. Of course, if this cargo wagon wasn't there. So now it's green, you know, both sides are green for each train to pass. So again, if, for example, this wasn't here, this would turn blue. That means this train can't get there, and the following train that wants to go to the right cannot do so and must wait for this train to pass through before going, you know, along. So what I usually do is on every pole, I put up a rail signal. And what that does, this spacing is pretty much perfect for the setup that I run, which is three cars, a locomotive and two cargo cars, right? So to demonstrate that, I will connect them up just like so, give this train some fuel, and go right in between these two poles. As you can see, the train fits perfectly in between those two poles, in between these two stoplights. You might even have, yeah, you can even put up another car. So you can have a four wide train stopping in between these two poles and allowing another train to come through. So if this train passes here, the next one will have to stop here. And if I pass into here and I actually add the rail signals on one side and the other, then the next train will have to stop here and not all the way over there. So E keeps the trains moving, right? So obviously you don't want to have these rail signals be too close to each other, and you don't want them to be too far apart. So find that medium balance for your size train. For my size, this works absolutely perfectly. But for you, if you have, say, four cargo or six even, you know, two locomotives and like four cargo train or four cargo cars, you may want to delete some of these on longer tracks. Longer trains will probably clog up these roundabouts, so you would have to make them bigger. But I will show you how I make my roundabouts. So I usually start off with a pole. This gives me, almost always run electricity along the tracks because, well, you probably need electricity where you're going anyways. You know, you usually want to stop at a mining site, right, and create a station there and power up all your miners. So might as well run the pole, the electric poles along the track to provide you that electricity as soon as you get there. And these are great, I think, markers for the trains. So what I usually do is place a power pole down and make sure that I can put my train tracks on either side just like this with one space in the middle. You should be able to fit two turrets in between those. Now, if your power pole is slightly skewed or slightly offset, I mean, here, you will only be able to place a train track here and train track here. Or, of course, I mean, if it's here, it'll be offset. So when you're placing it down the middle, make sure when you place it, you don't place your tracks too close. Okay, otherwise the circle will be messed up. So what I need to do is place my transport belt 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Five of these, you know, in between. Or 9 total, 1, 2, 3, 4 spaces here will be 9 total. I place my train track down just like this. I hold shift and I make my loop, right? So I can do rotate, right? And I make my loop just like so. Place R again. And you can, now sometimes it will do, Now you have to play around with this a bit because right now it just wants to do my loop that way. Now it wants to do this way. Now actually, from what I know, if you don't want to end up right over here because that will add an extra a track down the middle. You do not want to do a loop like that. So you need to do your loop, you know, like that, where this extra train track is not there. So if you want to make a blueprint out of that, you can put it in. Otherwise, you have to do it on the right side, I guess. So instead of here, let me just quickly do it on this side. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Track there. Shift click. Press R a couple of times to rotate it, and boom, there we go. So do it on the left side and you'll get that perfect circle. And you can delete this one because I messed that up. Because if I did it where this track would be here, we actually don't want it there. The circle will be too large. It'll still be a circle, but it won't be a perfect circle. And see, this is what I mean. I placed an extra one here down at the bottom. So now I have to delete it real quick and let's shift click. So regular click just to build along the track, and as you can see, I messed up again. I could delete that and make my full circle, perfect circle, just like so. And of course I got another one here. All right, so then I will extend this pole down as far as it can go, right there. That's as far as it can go. And I will put a train track here, here. I extend them up a little bit. I think here is good. Place the arrow and run along until I can see that it's matching the circle and click, and then just kind of go around the circle a bit, and yeah, now it's all connected. Do the same thing here. If I leave it there, you see it's not connected. You see that little part over there? That means it's not connected. That's like a stop, you know, for the train. You don't want that there. So you click on the arrow, make sure you complete it so it all runs smoothly. And that's how you do a roundabout. Okay, so say you ran your tracks all the way up to an ore field, right? And you want to mine it out, but you gotta put that ore in the train. So you gotta make a train station for it. Now, what you don't want to do is make a train station right along these tracks. You know, a train would be stopped there and would prevent all the other trains from coming in or passing through. So it will create traffic. Pretty much a train traffic jam. So what you do want to do is split off the main line and actually make a station. So I use these poles, again, these poles are great for markers, so I use them all the time. So I have my entrance here, I pick up the train tracks, I hold shift, click on the arrow, enter that blueprint mode. So what I'm looking for, so first of all, I gotta rotate it right. And this is what I'm looking for, like a like an old S sort of curve, right? So I want to place it, you know, the distance depends on how much you want. You can make it, you know, there. I usually just make it like the closest I can to the actual track. So place it down, and then I run it along, rotate my my end here so it can merge back into the track, and I skip one, because that is way too close, and bring it back somewhere around where, you know, behind the light, so just like so. Then there is my split off, and here I can actually, if I have robots, they will build this automatically. I will just have to go and finish this up manually, just like so. I'm just running, clicking whenever I need to place this down. Like that. And like that. Alright. So now we have this section here, perfect for a station. It will fit a whole train in there, no problem. So what we do is grab our train stop, place it somewhere here. This was good. Just make sure you can place a chain signal. Remember, this is an entrance. Right, this is an entrance to go into here, so we need a chain signal. Otherwise, the train will stop at this light, and we do not want it blocking either this way, or if the train's coming from this way, we don't want it blocking this train going onto the merging back onto the track. So you want to place a chain signal right after your train stop. You will also want to place the chain signal behind this intersection for this part, and you know, keep this line open. You also want to put a regular rail signal behind here, and another one, which I just ran out of. Oh no! So I will just steal one. I will steal one from here. There. See, that one doesn't really matter, right? So I will place one right over here. Now, we again do not want the train stopping either here or here. These are the exits to this little intersection, so we need to replace this signal with a chain signal now, because we want any trains entering this way, this fork in the road, in the tracks, we want the train to stop before it and not at it. So this is an entrance, so we place a chain signal there. And these two are exits, so we place a regular signal here. And again, these are two entrances, and this is an exit, so we place the signals accordingly. So I'm going to move this train and put it, and as you can see, we can fit a perfect three cars here, you know, one locomotive and and two cargo wagons. Now, if I extend this a bit, I think I can actually fit four. Let's see if I can do that real quick. Just to see if it works. Maybe here. Let's see how far this goes. Nope. How about here? There we go. See, now we can actually fit four cars just by extending it by one here. And that's still in front of this chain signal. So three cargo cars can fit in here with a locomotive. Now, if you want, you can, of course, extend your train station to be much further. You can have it span along this whole, you know, train track and actually have another one going off, say, in like, I'm going to do it from this side. So let's see, start from here and go, say, like that, right? That's probably too close, but you can even have a double train station. Interesting fact is that if you name these, so say this is called A, right? And this is called A. If there is a train already here, the next train that's coming in from this direction that needs to stop at A will not wait at this train signal and actually go to this A station. So these train stations are treated the same as the same name. So a train with a station name A will stop at either of these because they are called A. If you call them B, both of them B, you know. They will both stop here. Of course, you can name this one A, this one B, and then have the train go specifically to either A or B. And so that is how I build my my train stations. Now, I usually have some sort of loading and unloading mechanism going on. One thing that I like to do is if it's at my base, right? So if this is my base station, I usually have a, an inserter here going like that with a steel chest or a requester chest. If you already at the part of the robots, you can have a requester chest here requesting ore or perhaps even wood, any type of fuel going into this train. So as the train is coming along into the train station, it will get fueled up. If you look back at the very beginning of this video at this train station, you can see that there is a line of ore coming in and getting loaded or getting ready to load into any locomotive that pulls up in this station. Now for the offloading, I usually do something like blue inserters going like this, and if it's loading, going like this, a whole bunch of chests so it can fit six, right? And I ran out of chests, but you get the idea. And then these going in, these going out, and then up this way or that way, and then splitters like so. These are actually going the wrong way. Oops. More like that. I'm missing one here, of course. But you get the idea. So now, anything that, say, you're getting all this ore, right, is getting loaded up here. You don't have to, you know, this is how you would combine them all, going into all these chests. Now, these chests act like a buffer, okay? So as the train is out somewhere, right, your chests are getting filled with ore, so when the train comes in, it has all the ore ready to load up. You can take the advantage of stack inserters, right, or inserter stack upgrade. Let's see, where is that located? I don't even know if I did. There we go, inserter capacity bonus, right? So from chests, it will take up to, geez, I don't remember, seven? Yeah, so it can take up to, I guess, seven items and place them in the cargo train at once. Instead of taking one by one as they're coming in down the line, it will just take a whole bunch, place them in the wagon, and so the train gets loaded up faster and it gets out of the way quickly, getting ready, you know, for the other train to come in and fill that one up. Same thing as unloading, you know, you don't want to train your train stations to hold up anything, so if you have multiple ones running and this one is standing here and there's another one waiting to get on, is blocking this way, I mean, yes, of course you can add two stations, you can have another one here, or you could just, you know, also expedite the movement. You can, what I didn't show, is you go into the train and add a station, say base 10, and though you want to empty all your inventory out, but say it just takes too long, so you can add another condition, an add wait condition here, and you could say time passed, okay? If you wanted to just stay there for a minimum of 30 seconds, you can have it at and. If you wanted to stay as a maximum of 30 seconds, you click and you change it to an or. So it will either go, you know, when 30 seconds has passed, or the whole inventory has been emptied, or it has to wait at least 30 seconds and the inventory has to be empty as well. So you can play around with all these wait conditions as well. This is a new feature added in .13 version. So if you're watching this, you probably already have this feature, but play around with your wait conditions and see how long you want your train to be stopped. Gonna increase the time. Maybe you want even just item count, right? Certain conditions, inactivity, whatever. Experiment, see what you like. See how the train network responds. If you have multiple trains going on, this is extremely useful. Another thing to say is having these split of fork sort of things is very good if you have places that say you want to stop at. So if I'm going on my train and I'm going manually, right, and I stop here at this station, it's nice to have another fork, perhaps, maybe, so the trains can go around me while I am stopped. So if I am stopped here and there's no train here, the trains will just go around me and continue on their merry way. They will not have to wait for me to leave. Of course, if I'm here and this train's here, they will definitely have to stop. So yeah, if you have like an empty sort of roundabout sort of fork, if you had a fork here, just a little fork, you know, just like this, going like that, and your train just fits here, all the other trains would just go around you, and you can have your own personal stop. You don't need to name it or anything, but you know, just make sure you put your chain signals and your regular signals at the proper locations. You know, again, just remember, if it's an exit, you put a regular one, but if it's an entrance, you gotta put that chain signal on there so you don't clog up the actual intersections. So I quickly jumped into another map to show you guys one more feature that is extremely useful, and that is this trains menu over here. If you click on that, you can see all of your trains that you have on your network here, and you can click on whatever one. So for example, let's see, this one is, what is it? Train stop Iron Southwest. So which one is running that? So there's two right there. This one's just left. You could see this one left, and this one is right there. It stopped. So if I click on that, you can see a big map right there. That's the train, and it's gonna follow the train right there. It's following the train as it goes. You can also click this little toggle button, and you can actually see what the train is doing. It's going out carrying this iron ore on its merry way. It's gonna drop it off somewhere. You can actually manually control it from here. Add stations, wait conditions, whatever you want. Manage the train however you want, except for, of course, to get in there and add fuel. So the fuel tab is missing. You can change the color and you can change the schedule. So it's really extremely useful feature. Definitely use it a lot, especially when you have tons of trains like I do running on the network. So very, very, very helpful. So another thing that I want to mention is radars and turrets that you might have seen being placed around these electric poles, sometimes in the middle of these roundabouts. The radars give me perfect coverage with the minimal amount. There's a tutorial on them somewhere down in the description below, so check that out. And as far as the turrets, I usually do place them next to the big electric poles in addition to the light and the rail signals. Now these turrets were pretty weak by themselves. I usually put like 25 ammo in them. I don't spend the whole 100. They are good for kind of alert. So you'll know that the biters are coming up, and that area that you have the turret set up is probably going to get attacked soon in a larger force if you keep going. You know, usually it's like a couple of biters that usually come in, and then you get a bigger force. So these are good, like an early warning system. They're not necessarily there for complete protection, but they do stop biters from coming in further, so they reduce the amount of them coming into your base. So I think that's really nice to put them along the tracks for those reasons. So there you have it. That is all I know about trains. I am back here at my base station, and I encourage you guys to decorate your base stations as I have done here. I've utilized the new concrete strips and put my car in here and park. On the left you can see a steel chest with coal, getting ready to load it in the train in case it needs some, in order for it to go. So that's all I got. If you have any questions about anything that I covered in this video, please leave a comment down below. I'll do my best to get back to you. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up. Subscribe if you haven't already. I'll have more tutorial videos coming out, so look out for those. But that's all from me. Thanks for watching, and I will see you guys next time.